I have drifted away. I was distracted and lost sight of the shore. The waves keep growing larger. I thought I could navigate this myself. Without you, I have grown tired and weary. I must realign my compass toward Christ once more. The pages of Scripture become my map, leading me through the tumultuous waters. With dedicated time spent with God, I feel the waters start to recede. I remind myself who my God is. He calls himself the Mighty God, the Creator, Father, the God Most High, Prince of Peace, the Beginning and the End. Lord, I repent of my sin and selfish ways. Just as a ship needs a captain, my life requires the guidance of a Savior. Christ is the anchor that holds me firm, preventing me from drifting aimlessly. It's through him that I'm guided back to safety. And no matter how many times I drift away, I know God is calling me home.
Good day, family. I, of course, am Reverend Hayden Madlock III, and it is my duty, it is my privilege to bring to you the PowerPoint message for this Sunday. PowerPoint being the official online ministry of Carter Metropolitan CME Church here in Detroit, Michigan. Before getting started with today's sermon, allow me the opportunity to thank my friend, my pastor, my presiding elder, that is none other than the Reverend Dr. Twana A. Harris. Thank you so much, Doc, for allowing me to bring to the people what God has given me to share. And of course, that second to none team, the ministerial staff here at Carter Metropolitan, thank you for making this journey just that much smoother. I appreciate you and I love you. And without further ado, allow me to bring to you our scripture for today. Our scripture for today will be taken from the book of 1 John. That is the second chapter, and we're going to start around the 15th verse. I'll be reading this from the New International Version, and it reads, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires will pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever." That is the word of God for the people of God. And together we say, thanks be to God. Please bow with me. Father God, it is sermon time. Your people have gathered here at this appointed time, Father God, not to hear from me, but Lord, to hear a word from you. So, Father, I ask you to hide me behind your cross, Father. May they only hear and see you, Lord. Father, at this time, they are here, they are willing to follow whatever it is you will have for them, Father. And we will be so ever grateful, giving you all the honor, praise, and glory. It is in the matchless name of Jesus we pray. And may all of us say, amen. Now, I know about this time of year, in this Lenten season, we have been on a constant journey talking about the road to the cross. However, I chose this particular passage of scripture. I didn't choose it. It chose me. But this particular passage of scripture, it's not in the category or realm of that road to the cross. However, I'll tell you what it really is. It is how we get off or out of formation for Christ. You see, all of those people who were following God, following Christ during his ministry, these were the same folks who were in the crowd when they began to ask for the crucifixion. These were the same people who were gathered around the cross at Golgotha when they strung Jesus up on Calvary. These were the same people who Jesus died to save. But how did things go so wrong so quickly? See, during this time, we have a knack for thinking about those people as them. They're separate from us. But just as you heard me say that these are the same people that were in the crowd that were screaming, "Crucify him," these were the same people when Jesus entered as a triumphant king, who were on both sides of the road throwing palm branches down for his coat to walk on, who were laying their coats down, not for his feet, but for just the feet of the beast that he was riding. These are the same people. These people were us. We're up in praise and hallelujah when Jesus actually sees things the way that we see them, and things go the exact same way that we pray. We're those people. But then things go oh so wrong in our lives. But why? There's some conflicting things that happen in the life of Christians. Sometimes when you talk to, I will not call them holy rollers, when you talk to people who have been in the church for a certain length of time, longer than you, they'll tell you that it is not right to enjoy certain things. Let me please explain to you that God put things in the world for you to enjoy. He did. God did not mean for you to suffer your entire life as you are following him. That is not what the word of God said. Now, will there be some suffering? Yes, there will. Will there be some hard times? Yes, there will be some hard times. But of course, we don't accept hard times the way other people do. Why? Because we know where to look when it comes to relieving us of our stress, of our pain, of our anguish. We don't accept the things of the world like people of the world do. The most important part of that is the fact that it is your duty to show the world how to live with God, which will relieve them of the pressures and the stress of the world. But as you heard in these verses, you heard Brother John trying to explain to people that they will stumble in this life. There's going to be some times when they're going to look towards the world and not to God, which is the direction they should be looking. But even when you do that, there is a God who will come and intercede on your behalf. How do you know this? Because that's what Calvary was for. That's what the cross was for. See how I veered away from talking about Easter or the road to the cross just to bring you back into formation. Everything that he's talking about has to do with living with and loving God. See, if you love the world, then you can't love God, because everything in the world tells you that it's about lust. It is about total lust. It is about wanting the things of the world and not the things of God. People of God, understand that God will grant you your wildest dream. The idea is this, though. If you are in God, the dreams that you have will not be the things that the world lusts for. The things that you will dream are the things of God, things that God would want you to have. Do you want a nice house? Do you want a nice car? Are those the things that you dream about? Or is your dream more surrounded around living and loving life and the people of God? See, we talk so much about how we love one another and how we love God. Truth of the matter is, a lot of us just love the world and the things that the world have to offer. We've talked recently more and more about the fact that the world can offer you whatever, but God owns it all. We worship the resources and we never worship the source, or we don't look to the source until after we have cried over the resources for so long. Understand that the world does not develop anything. God built the entire world. So love for the Father is love for the one who created the world. And then, if we continue to seek God's face, if we continue to seek what God wants us to have and who God wants us to be, family, it is hard for me not to contain the things that I really want to say. But if we continue to seek God, there is nothing that God will hold back from you, his child. Nothing. The reason why he won't hold things back from you as his child is because he knows that everything that he gives to you, you will share with his children. You're not seeking the things of the world just so that you can hold them to yourself. I'm only talking to the people who understand what I'm talking about. Because there's some of us who only want things so that we can hold on to them and show the world that we can shine. You cannot exalt yourself. We try so hard to show people that we are worth paying attention to. We're worth understanding. We are worth loving. We don't love ourselves enough to know that God is the one whom we worship. God is the one who we try to prove our worth to. Why? Because he is the only one who can exalt you, not the world. We have to stop lusting after the things of the world. Because as soon as you don't have anything left in the tank, the world does what the world does and throws you back from whence you came. Those are the times when we get on our knees and tell God how much we love him when the world has turned its back. Here's the thing, family. Our God has never and will never turn his back on you. It is us who turn and go in the other direction. Now, let me just tell you this, because all the stuff that I just said, it sounds like I don't live in the same world as you. Mentally, I don't, but yeah, physically I do. But let me give it to you like this. The reason why a lot of times we turn our back and go the other direction, and say things like God doesn't pay attention and all of these things is because when you ask for certain things in the world, ask for certain things, excuse me, to God, it doesn't show up in the physical in the way that you thought that it should. And because it doesn't show up in the way that you thought that it should show up, you say things like, God ain't listening to me. God doesn't talk to me. When you ask for money and God gives you a job, when you ask for a big old house and God allows you to get an apartment because you have to train yourself up for ownership. When God actually does things, he does all of these things not to embarrass you, not so that you'll feel weak. But he does these things just so that when you receive what you've been wanting from God, you are able to use it in the way that God wants you to use it. There are plenty of us who have asked God for things, and you've asked for so long that God said, okay, you've asked for this, but you keep ignoring every messenger I send to you. So let me give you what you asked for. Let me open up the gates of heaven and give you what you've been asking for so that you can see what I'm trying to teach you. And he gives you a piece. He gives you a little part, small part of what you asked for. And in a quick amount of time, it's gone. And the very next thing out of your mouth is, why God? Because I told you you aren't ready. In this passage of scripture, 1 John, 2nd chapter, John is explaining to the people exactly that. See, the world will give you just enough to keep you coming back to beg it. When God gives it to you, it is free, it is open. He gives it to you because you're his child, and this is how he treats his family. Because he knows that as his child, that thing that you have asked for will be used in a way that it enriches your life and it enriches the lives of everyone around you and people that you come in contact with. Constantly, family, we try to make God a liar. And even that never works. So on this Sunday, what I'm asking you to do is stop looking at the world for a solution. Because the answer you already have. The answer is in the Word of God. The answer is God. You are the answer. Open that book that sits on that table in your house. You know the book, the one that even now when you open it, it cracks a little bit. For those younger spirited of you, open up that app on your phone. Now, this is Sunday, so I already know you open it at least once, but do it more often. Understand why it is that God is doing what he's doing. Now, I didn't tell you to try and understand God, because that is an exercise that you will burn the rest of your life trying to understand. What I'm trying to tell you is this: the reason why God is doing the things that he is doing for you is because he loves you. But just like God loves you, God needs you to love him more than you love the resources that he gives. So in closing, family, it is my prayer to God that you understand that he loves you more than you can understand. It is my prayer to God that you get off of your me, my, and I, and understand that it's just you and him. The things that you lust after, the things of the world are not for you. The Bible says that we may be in the world, but we are not of the world. We are living this physical life, but we have our spiritual existence. We are going back to that. Enjoy what you're doing and enjoy life. God did not mean for you to come down here and just suffer and suffer and suffer and then die. That part is not in the word. And if anybody tells you that it is, they, like a bunch of us, do not read the word. God means for you to enjoy life. God means for you to enjoy life and bring his kingdom here. Why? Because there are people out there who need to know the God that you love. And not just the resources that our God, the source, supplies. So that is my prayer for you. And this has been the word of God for the people of God. And together we say thanks be to God. Be blessed.
Right now.
ready for the benediction. Allow me to present the benediction as this. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon all of you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards all of you and give you peace now, henceforth, and forevermore. And may the people of God say amen, amen, and amen. Be blessed.